pleasure to welcome Jose Carrillo back. As some of you remember, he was visiting early in January and is now back as part of the interview for the endowed chair position. And it's not going to take much of his time, but I want to say just a little bit about the background. So since 2012, he's held the chair in applied numerical analysis at Imperial College London. He was formerly the ICRIA research professor at the University Automatic of Barcelona. This was 2003 to 2012. He's been a visiting professor at a number of French universities, and I'm not going to take his time by listing them all. He's spent a lot of time at various places. He serves as chair of the Applied Mathematics Committee of the European Mathematics Society, and been recognized with the SEMA Prize in 2003, von Mises Prize in 2006, and recipient of the Wolfson Research Merit Award by the Royal Society. So it's really a pleasure to have you back, and you can see the title of his presentation, so I'll turn it over to you at this point, and thank you for being here.
Thank you very much, Rob, for the presentation. So today, I would like to make a kind of more broader talk about research that I'm interested in general, and especially, I would like somehow to convince you that kinetic modeling is a good tool for doing this, going from micro dynamics, from microscopic models to macroscopic models. So I would like to explain you a bit different applications that were related to my research, about my career, and why kinetic equations always have been the right tool for doing the connection between the different scales of the problem. And in the second part, I will discuss things about macroscopic. Oops. Yeah, so as I said, first I would like just to list several applications that somehow are historical or related to my research in which kinetic models and kinetic equations make a difference. So probably one of the historical applications of the kinetic theory and the reason why Boltzmann introduced kinetic theory at the end of the 19th century is precisely to deal with the question of rarefied gases. So he wanted somehow to explain the departure from the typical fluid mechanics equations that you can see for gases which are not condensed. And in fact, he wanted also to make a connection between the microscopic dynamics governed by Newton's law and macroscopic equations for fluid mechanics. So here you have the case of this of the re-entry of a spaceship in the upper atmosphere, which is one of the typical cases in which you can have these rarefied gases happening. It's very important in order to capture the thermal effects that are so important for the safe re-entry of the spaceship. So somehow these trigger a lot of the research in kinetic theory in the beginning of the 80s, precisely, to get a good, still does, to get a good, accurate computation of these equations in the right regions. Okay, we'll come back later on to this. Good, sorry. Not working as good as it should. Okay, why is doing that? Good. So, next application I wanted to discuss is something that I really got involved when I was a postdoc in Austin. It was about trying to explain the formation of paradigm waves in granular media, in granular materials. So, in fact, here there are some researchers in this department doing research in these granular materials, in fact. And here you have some the simulation of some of the fluid mechanics equations that you can derive out of the kinetic equations for elastic interactions. And the idea was to try to, again, see that the equations that you get through kinetic theory that you derive through use of this mesoscopic scale are useful in order to predict the formation, the onset of this system. Here, essentially, what you see is probably, if I can
run the simulation from the beginning. What you see is this very thin layer of, let's say, glass beads, if you want, that you shake vertically in certain amplitude and frequency, and depending on the amplitude and frequency, it was done in experiments by the Swedish lab in Austin, the kind of standing wave pattern that you will see on the surface. And here are the simulations of the granular hydrodynamic equations that you obtain by doing some kind of closure out of the kinetic equations. I will explain just a little bit more later. So it's just different applications. Another applications in which I work quite a lot, in the use of kinetic theory, is in charged particle transport in semiconductors. In fact, this was part of the work that I started when I was a postdoc in Austin also, with Irene Gamba and Xiwan Shu, that we collaborated for quite a few years in the direct numerical simulation of the kinetic equations in semiconductors and comparing with the hydrodynamics and grid diffusion-like equations again. So it's a kind of bridge between the macroscopic dynamics and the large scale dynamics. So in fact, we develop somehow quite efficient numerical schemes for those equations. Let's see if this works. Doesn't work. Okay, so, yeah, it's funny. Good. So this is another field of application of these ideas of kinetic theory, in which I got involved 10 years ago, essentially. It's about trying to describe the collective behavior of a large amount of cells that are driven by chemotaxis. Here you probably saw this kind of experiment in which there is a guy with a pipette putting a little bit of the substance for which these cells are attracted to, and then they direct their movement towards the source of that gradient. And here you have the overall picture of the whole cell cycle of the stellar discoideum, that is kind of the typical sample that people always mention for the movement by chemotaxis. So again, here is about trying to model this aggregation that you saw in that probably in this movie, if I repeat it again, that in which you go from these kind of individual behavior of the different cells to form a kind of aggregate, and then they have a different kind of dynamics. Okay. So what you want, again, to do is to explain this overall behavior of the system based on the interactions that you assume from the particles. And the particles here, in some sense, are these cells. Okay. Good. So here you have the example that probably I discuss a lot in my talk in January, because I went far more in detail in terms of some models for swarming. And here again is the same kind of question. You want to explain the emergence of these large coherent structures in the swarm of fish or in birds, and the movement of these flocks of birds, these fish schools, out of the assumptions that you do in the interaction between the different individuals forming of the group of animals. Okay? So, what's the connection between all of these applications? It seems that they are quite diverse and quite unrelated a priori. So, in fact, they are connected through a famous problem that was already posed by Hilbert at the beginning of the 20th century. Lecture that he gave at the International Conference of Mathematicians. And somehow the common point is that you want to explain the interaction of a large number of particles, and in each of the different applications I showed you before, and many others, particles mean something different. For radical gases, you have gas molecules. For granular media, you have these glass beads if you want. For semiconductors, you have electrons and holes. For basochemotactic cells, for swarming, you will have depending on what you want to explain, what you want to study, group of individuals, pedestrians, animals. And in many other cases, there are different kind of particles in different applications you want to study. I'm just listing several of other classical examples of application of kinetic theory. Of course, the devil here is in the details in how you model each of the cases, and the question is how you obtain the macroscopic equations. In fact, that was exactly the statement of the Hilbert 6 problem when he posed it in the case of the rarefied glass dynamics. He wanted to ask how you can rigorously derive the macroscopic equations for fluids from the macroscopic equations governed by Newton's law. So that was exactly the question that he had. And precisely, some of the answers to this big problem have been done or have been done recently by certain researchers in kinetic theory. So let me just then go into a bit of the details of kinetic equations, and I'll give you two typical examples of kinetic equations which I have worked with and for different of these for some of these applications I mentioned before. So first, the key ingredients. And this is more a kind of historical view of kinetic theory. So the idea is essentially that if you want to describe the system, you cannot do it by describing the behavior of each of the particles or each of the individuals in the system. Essentially, for instance, in a gas, you will have 10 to the 23 in average molecules in a given, let's say, cubic centimeter of a typical gas. And then what you have to do, or what you have with one of the posters that in fact Maxwell came with, is to have a statistical description. So you don't want to know the precise state of the system, you want to know averages. And average, for obtaining averages, what you have to know is the probability distribution or the mass distribution of particles, and particles are in the phase state. So you assume that position and velocity are independent, and you just count how many particles you may have in position and velocity. That is the typical application in the case of gas molecules. Or you can think about charged particles in a semiconductor material. So he came up with this idea, and he somehow introduced the notion of thermal equilibrium. So notion of the Maxwell, which is nothing else than a Gaussian in the velocity space. Okay, and then how to obtain the relevant quantities of interest. You want to know probably about particle density, and the particle density at a given position x, you will find it by taking the average of the velocity, so just this zero at the moment. You would like to know the mean velocity, but the mean velocity is just expectation in velocity. But to get expectation in velocity, of course, you have to divide by rho to get the normalized probability. So f divided by rho will be the normalized probability at the minimum position x. And then you can compute the mean velocity. Or what is the variance in the velocity distribution? And then you will need to compute the second order moment in velocity. So just again, this kind of moment, V minus U Tx squared F Tx V, will define you the temperatures and again the normalization of F at the position x. Okay, so these are just basic quantities of interest at the macroscopic level. How you will recover those equations? I mean, we will come back to that later and I'll give you some examples. So let me just now introduce two of the typical kinetic equations. The first is the Vlasov equation. The Vlasov equation, in fact, can be understood as a mean field limit. What it means, mean field limit? It means that you want to understand what is the behavior of a large set of, in principle, ODEs. You can do that for a large set of stochastic differential equations too. And here I'm just giving an example in one particular case of the applications I mentioned before. So in the case of swarming, this probably you saw in my previous talk. So here, in this particular model, I'm just taking a basic microscopic model, the model introduced by Rossoni, Bertozzi, and collaborators, in which they introduced this basic Newton equations of interaction between individuals, explaining the somehow the attraction or repulsion, or modeling the attraction or repulsion between the different individuals in the group by just an effective potential. Potential which they assume is just a function of the radius, for simplifying your life, and assuming that it's repulsive in the short distance and attractive in the long distance. To make, if you want this more realistic, you can restrict, assuming that you have cone vision or a great region of sensitivity of the different particles, and do this or reduce this average to the right regions, and this can be done. It has been done by many people in field. And here, apart from that effect, you have this term fixing the asymptotic speed. Okay, it's just an example of this kind of large system of ODEs. And what you would like to have is if you can derive some PDEs, some partial differential equation, that will give you the overall behavior of the system when the number of particles goes to infinity, in a sense, the mean behavior of the system. In order to do that, you need, in fact, to do assumptions of the scaling of this potential, depending on the number of particles that you have. And essentially, that scaling is like assuming that the strength of the potential is of the order of 1 over the number of particles. In this way, the total kinetic energy of the system, or the total force felt by any particle in the system, is of order 1 when you send n on. And in this way, you can derive the mean field limit, which by itself is a very interesting mathematical question. And write the PDEs associated to that. Just to give you, before writing the PDEs, just to give you before that, typical patterns that you see by solving numerically those equations, and that you can see also analytically at the level of the PDE, are this kind of flock pattern or knee pattern that somehow are why this model got so interesting from the point of view of the researchers in swarming, in the sense that he was able to reproduce these two patterns depending on the initial data that you take even for the same value of the parameters. And so if you do the mean field limit when the number of particles goes to infinity, I just want to wait for the formation of the amino, which is coming. So after a while, it seems that there is an ordering chaos there, and you get that. So you can, as I said, do this kind of limit, which assumes these scaling on the number of particles. You assume that all particles are equal, this nj is exactly 1 over n, is what I was saying before it works. And in order to do more rigorously the passage to the limit when n goes to infinity, the question is if you can characterize what's the limit of that probability measure, which is called the empirical measure of the system of ODEs. So essentially here you're assuming the movement is deterministic, you know the position and velocity of each of the individuals, so then the probability of finding a particle at position x and velocity v is given by this sum of Dirac deltas at the position at time t. And in this particular case, you can identify then what's the PDE for the limiting of these empirical measures, and they have to be weak solutions of that loss of lag equation. So this is the first example of a PDE of a kinetic type, in which you have this, everything is, if you want, a first order equation, you have all of them are transport terms. And the nonlinearity comes here in the force field, because the F itself depends on the density of individuals. Remember that the position of each individual is producing an attractive or repulsive force on the others. So this is measuring this convolution-like interaction. Okay? So we have this nonlinear quadratic term for you. So in fact, for the last of the equation, yes, probably I will make this comment after the next slide. For the Maxwell equation, there have been many other applications and other interesting questions. I will discuss that after this. So just to comment that you can also introduce noise onto the system of particles. I mean, you add Brownian motion to that set of all these before. Here I'm doing it just for one particle, so the equation that we get is linear. You can do it also for the nonlinear system of particles. What you get is what is called the Russell-Fokker-Planck system, in which you have some second-order operator in velocity in the right-hand side of the Russell equation. That's why it's called Fokker-Planck. It is referred to this kind of operator in velocity space. So this introduces some diffusion in velocity in the system and some, in fact, typical stationary state in the velocity variable. So one can see easily that the Gaussian e to the minus b squared over 2 theta, suitably normalized, is a stationary state of that operator. So it defines what is the thermal equilibrium already in the system in this case. So as I said, you can do it in the nonlinear case, and you have nonlinear couple, class of Poisson or class of Fokker-Planck equation. So for, I mean, this is usually called the class of Fokker-Planck. If the potential here comes from the Poisson equation, it's called the class of Poisson Fokker-Planck equation. And in fact, as you might know, for this system, when the potential is, as I said, in the solution of the Poisson equation, Poisson equation. There have been a lot of recent research, especially related to how you can connect to the stability of the stationary state of that system. And it's one of the reasons why Semiconductor and Eagles, this field's level in 2010, because together with Thomas Moore, they were able to understand the feature of the Poisson equation that is called an endothelial. But that's another story. Okay, so this was just to give you an idea of some of the equations that we are interested in. Another big family of equations that somehow I used in some of the applications before, in fact, I use this kind of modeling for the granular media equations, although I will not write you the granular media Boltzmann equation, I will write you just the classical Boltzmann equation. So there you are trying to model the collision directly between particles. And collision, you don't have, well, you can think about collision like billiard balls. That would be the case of what is called hard spheres. But you can think about collision, about just a very close interaction between two particles, not really physical collision. So this depends exactly on how you assume the interaction. But let's think about the case of billiard balls. So in that case, you have to study carefully how you're going to assume that they collide. So in that case, you assume that you have some pre-collisional state, so you have two particles, one in the position of x and velocity v. The other particle that is going to collide with the first one is at the position x minus the radius phi of the particle in a certain direction that I call n. And n is some vector, a unit vector on the sphere. Let's assume that we are doing this in 3D. And let's assume that the collision between the particles is elastic. This means that you're going to have conservation of the mean of the momentum and conservation of the energy. So just by imposing conservation of momentum and energy, you can find the post-collisional velocities after the collision that I call V prime and V prime star in terms of the collision. Collisional velocities, which are v and v star. And you can write that in this form, in particular, by using as a parameterization sigma, which is a unit vector, not the one related to EMB star, but this sigma that is on this picture. So essentially, you can prove that any pair of post-collisional velocities lies in the same sphere centered at the center of the mean velocity of the pre-collisional velocities, EMB star, with the radius, the right radius, depending on the total energy. And with that, you can do this parameterization of the post-collisional velocities. So once you have this parameterization of all possible collisions, this is what Boltzmann did in 1877, he proposed to write an equation for the probability distribution of particles in phase space. And in some sense, he was doing a kind of limit when the number of particles goes to infinity, but scaling also the radius of the particles. And this is where the rarefied gas assumption enters. In the sense, he was doing this kind of asymptotic limit, going the number of particles goes to infinity, the radius of the particle goes to zero, in such a way that nr squared is of order 1. This is what it means that it's ratified. Okay? So he was assuming that we have localized collisions. He was assuming also that collisions are elastic, it's reversible, as I was explaining in the previous slide. And he was also assuming that particles, once they collide, they somehow forget that they have collided and they can collide again and again and again. So this is what he means for Lemberghaus assumption. But the distribution of particles after collision are independent, and they don't depend on the previous memory. So under all those assumptions, he was able to write, probably got the paper wrong, it's 1872, he wrote this equation, that is the famous Boltzmann equation, in which you have, on one hand, the transport part, the velocity, so the particles, if they don't collide, they just move with velocity v. This is what it is, this DFTP plus XF. And then on the right-hand side, you take into account all the collisions between the particles. And here you have two terms. You have the gain term and the loss term. The gain term is what I call here Q plus, and the loss term, I call it Q minus. And what do they represent? They represent the fact that due to a collision, you can gain particles with the velocity V. So this is what it means, the Q plus. It means that you have previously to the collision two particles with velocities V prime and V prime star, that due to the collision, they produce one particle with velocity V, which is the one that I encountered here. And this loss term takes into account that two particles with velocities V and V star, they collide, and as a result, the particle that we are studying with velocity V loses that velocity and changes that velocity. So that's why you have always these two terms in the right-hand side, taking into account the gain of the particles with the right velocity and the loss of particles with that velocity. And you have to integrate in five dimensions because, of course, you have, as a degrees of freedom, the vector that parameterizes the different collisions. You can have all kinds of different collisions with the different vector symbol, the different impact direction, depending on how the particles collide. And also, you iterate against the velocity of the other particle, because you have to take into account all the possibilities of the velocity of the other particle. The factor here, modulus of V minus V star, takes into account that we are working with half spheres, and that's the typical collision frequency that is called for the Boltzmann equation. I know that that's hard to follow, but in this, in the sense that in order to grasp a bit more about this PDE, you need to look at it carefully and understand how it works. But, you know,
can I ask a quick question on that? So you mentioned the molecular chaos. I tend to think more toward Wiener when I'm thinking chaos theory. How far did Boltzmann push that?
Well, I mean, the thing is that the molecular chaos assumption enters exactly here. Because F times F star is somehow the approximation that you do or the probability that two particles are going to collide, one with V, velocity V, and the other one with velocity V star.
Okay.
And he was assuming that the probability of two particles, of the joint probability of two particles, is the product
of the probability of one particle.
Right.
So
right.
That's
okay.
Exactly what where it enters.
Okay.
Here,
okay.
Here is the same.
Okay.
So he just assumed that there is no memory in the system.
Right. Right. Okay. Okay. Good. Thank you.
Yeah. I mean, this one is important because, of course, if you do, for instance, inelastic collision, you can assume that, but that's farther from reality.
Yeah.
If you
yeah.
do inelastic collisions.
Right. Right. Okay.
So you have to have a. Corrections to molecular cause assumption, and people have to work on that.
Okay, thank you.
No, no problem. So, why is important? I mean, what Boltzmann did that was really, really crucial and important, and that's why we still talk about this work after so many years, is that he was able to prove some theorem about this operator Q effect. So what was the theorem, the important theorem he was able to prove? So he was able to prove that QFF is equal to zero if and only if F is a mass weather, is in a thermodynamical equilibrium. That was the theorem that Boltzmann did. And it's really a theorem. You go to the book, original book of Boltzmann translated to French, you find where theorem and proof of that, which is quite geometrical. So I repeat again, the theorem that he proved was to characterize the kernel of this operator, characterize all possible probability distributions in velocity, look that this operator is local in both T and X. T and X only appear here, this is an iteration only in velocities. So he was able to say that all spatially homogeneous steady states of this equation are given just by the Gaussian U1, because Maxwellian, because it was given by Maxwell as a candidate for thermodynamical equilibrium. And so Q of F is equal to zero if and only if F is of that form, and you see it's parameterized by five numbers, which are the density, the mean velocity, and the temperature. Five parameters in R3. Of course, these rho u and theta will depend eventually on t and x, but in principle they are just constants if you are looking just for the steady states, which are not dependent on the space, so that are continuous. And how he did that? So the first thing that you need is to understand better the action of the operator q, and what you have to do is to work in what is called the weak formulation of the equation, see how q acts on test functions, and q acting on test functions, you see it's computed in this way, in which what you do is to look at the change of phi over a collision. This is what it means, phi of b prime and phi of b. So just to have something in mind, imagine that phi is b squared, you will see in this way the change of kinetic energy due to a collision. And in that case, it's conserved. So you could see that in the weak formulation, you have conservation of mass, momentum, and energy by choosing as phi, 1, b, and b squared. And by just choosing the fact that you have those conservation, what he really proved is that the only conserved quantities of the system are exactly mass, momentum, and energy. So he proved that phi of QFF is equal to zero for every F, if and only if phi is a linear combination of 1, b, and modulus of b squared. Okay? With that, also, in order to finish the proof, in fact, he introduced the notion of entropy. And the entropy that, I mean, the mathematical sense, you know, mathematicians are always pessimistic. The entropy for us decreases. For the physicists, it's always optimistic. The entropy for them increases. It's just a change of sign, but it's important. Okay, so for us, it's pessimistic. You see that after some years, we got a bit angry. So, yeah, probably he should have chosen the other sign, but he chose that sign. So, anyhow, so the famous Boltzmann-H theorem, he proved that the derivative in t of the integral of f log f is less or equal than zero. He proved that the integral of f log f is a Lyapunov functional for the PDE that I showed you before. And he wrote the precise form of the dissipation. This is 1872, okay? So he wrote the precise form of the dissipation that is done, it has that form, and just by using the property of the logarithm, that is an increasing function, you can see that this has a sign. So in fact, this was the crucial point why he got so angry. Because he was showing somehow that that equation is not reversible. There is some entropy, some dissipation. So somehow his equation has some irreversible dynamics. Nevertheless, he started with Newton's law for particles. So he started with reversible dynamics. So this created a lot of controversy at his time. And he had a lot of bad interactions, especially with Poincaré at that time. And well, you know that Boltzmann committed suicide. It's not known if this was due to the scientific bad interrelations that he had with many people at that time. But there was this side of it. Anyhow, somehow history gave him the reason that the way in which the equation has to be understood is in some particular limit, which is called by now the Boltzmann limit. That's the limit I was referring before. Boltzmann didn't write that kind of limit, and that's why it was the origin of that controversy, that now it's understood that in that kind of limit, and under certain assumptions, you can derive the Boltzmann equation. In fact, still, it's a kind of a research topic, very important, and people are working on that, especially the French people at the ENS. Okay, good. So now what's the connection with the fluid equations? So in fact, now you see, as I told you here, you have that the kernel of the operator is given by the Maxwellian, and then you have as parameters rho, u, and theta. So you can write, by going back to the kinetic equation, you can assume now that you're looking for a kind of local thermodynamical equilibrium, assuming that F is of the form of a Maxwellian, but where rho, u, and theta depends on T and X. If you just substitute it over here, and you compute moments, so you compute the integral of F, the integral of the beam velocity, the temperature, you can write closed equations for rho, u, and theta. And this was somehow the good thing about the Boltzmann equation, in the sense that he was able to obtain Euler equations, compressible Euler equations, directly from this closure with the Maxwellian. So, of course, deriving then rigorously and making a theorem out of it, it took many, many years. And they have been big advances by Wolfs and Northanderholm, and they obtain theorems in that direction. Okay, so, well, here somehow you see what you to just, this is the dimensionless version of the Boltzmann equation. Typically, you have 1 over epsilon in front of Q. Epsilon is referred as the Knudsen number. Going epsilon going to zero means that you are getting closer and closer to the fluid scaling, so in the sense that the gas is getting denser and denser. So in the epsilon going to zero limit is when you get the fluid equations. And here is just to give you some numerical simulation that I obtained from some friends' paper, in which you see the difference of the rho of the here I think I have the density, mean velocity, and temperature for different epsilons. So you see that this is the somehow the one of the main applications of kinetic theory historically was precisely to understand this for radioactive gases. So yeah, in the final part of my talk today, I just want to explain you again how to connect to other family of equations. So, in some sense, I want you to understand how kinetic equations play an important role in connecting the macroscopic to the macroscopic at the different levels. We saw before the fluid-like equations. I'm going to show you now how to get drift diffusion-like equations, so equations that only tell you the evolution of the density of particles. So somehow that's the general picture of the different scales that you have. You can think about the atomic scale. You have the kinetic scale, which is a kind of mesoscopic scale. Now I'm going to talk to you about the kind of diffusive scale when you look at the system from very far away. And certainly with other equations that you can derive for the coarse grain density. Okay, so I'm going to explain you that in a particular example. So let's take the case of the Russell Fokker Planck equation. So this, I did some research on kind of passing through the macroscopic equations, both theoretically and numerically. But I just want to explain you how to can derive at least formally these drift diffusion-like equations. This idea was introduced by Hilbert, in fact. He worked on some of these limits, asymptotic limits from kinetic equations. And he introduced the idea of what is called Hilbert expansion dynamic. So which is simple, is to look at an expansion. So first, you are starting with a scale dimensionless formulation of your glass of Fokker Planck equation. In this case, I have this right-hand side that has, as again, the Maxwellian too. And I see it in different time and space scales. That's why I have this epsilon, and epsilon is a very small parameter. So you see that you have, you can see different orders, terms with different orders in epsilon. So in order to derive the equation, what you do is assuming that the solution, you can expand it as a power series of the small parameter, epsilon, and then you look for the equation satisfied for the different orders, fk. So if you just look at in this equation to the zero order term, the zero order term is just a cube, and then it tells you that f0 has to be in the kernel of the operator q. In this case, for the Fokker-Planck equation, what you get is that f0 is a Maxwellian, but since this is the operator is much simpler than the Boltzmann equation, you don't have five parameters. You can parameterize everything in terms just of the density. And the theta is the given theta that you have here, which doesn't depend on Tnx. So this is the notation I'm taking about the Maxwellian. So in fact, you can prove that the kernel of this operator is just of that form. So it's a density that depends in Tnx times the Gaussian with temperature theta and the velocity. Now you go to the equation satisfied by F1. You just look at the terms of order epsilon in the equation. And then you have to solve, if you want to know exactly F1, you have to solve this equation, that you can do. But in principle, for what my purposes are, I don't need to solve it directly, because I'm going to do the following. I want to compute just the integral of df1. So I'm going to iterate. I multiply by d, sorry, and I iterate. So multiplying by d, I'm iterating, iterate by parts here. And believe me, from that, by multiplying by d, iterating, you get just this. And from here, you can compute the integrals. Assume f0 is the one given by density times the Maxwellian. So you can compute that what you get from the right-hand side can be written only in terms of rho, okay? Only in terms of the parameter that was defined in the zero-order mode, zero-order example. And now, if, in fact, you go here and you integrate in velocity and you keep just the zero-order, it's not difficult to see that what you get is this equation for the rho dt. So the continuity equation at the zero order gives you d rho dt plus divergent x of the first moment in velocity of f1. So now when you substitute this over here, you get this equation, which gives you what is called the drift diffusion equation for the density rho. You have Laplacian of rho times the temperature, and here you have the divergence of minus divergence of the force times rho. So you see, by doing this asymptotic expansion, you get at this first order a diffusion-like equation. Again, proving this rigorously needs some theory and some analysis, and essentially you can do that rigorously. It's called the diffusion limit for kinetic equations. So what's important about that is that you can find all the coefficients that you want in the limiting equation in terms of the macroscopic model. So you recover formulas for the temperature, for the mobilities, if they are important in the force field. Okay, so that essentially had a lot of influence in several applications of kinetic theory. So in semiconductors, people did a life out of studying the deep diffusion model for semiconductors for many years. Now, since there is no much more of research of semiconductor modeling in that direction, so this has been stopped a bit. But the same kind of model you can use it for obtaining the Federal Signal model for chemotaxis. So it's the kind of, essentially the same kind of asymptotic limit. And this I did with Bukhayan, and Alina has worked in that direction too, with some PhD student, I believe, here. And also, you can derive much in more general terms equations of that kind. Would you have a nonlinear diffusion term instead of just linear diffusion, and a general non-local interaction terms of that form? But I worked in that direction, both theoretically and numerically. Numerically, we did a nice work with Ben Pongwa and Marina for these are simulations that we need back in those cases of some of these equations. I don't want to explain that much what we have there, but essentially this is always an equation with an initial data with some aggregation term. For initial data, which is the characteristic of a set, you can do it again because it's nice. And this is a model that macroscopic model for sure. So in any case, also theoretically, you can understand plenty of properties by studying this equation from the point of view of gradient flow. And I discuss in general things in that direction. I don't want to enter today in any of the analytic side of that. Okay, so I don't have that much time left. So So the last few minutes I have, in fact, I want to discuss about a very recent application that I got interested in. And I thought that it would be nice to talk about this here, because there are some people with interest in optimization around. So recently, I have been trying to use these ideas of consensus of swarming to find minima of functions. So, of course, I don't have to explain that very challenging and complicated problem, which is to find the minimum of a function if the function is, in principle, quite complicated and regular. And there have been hundreds of papers, or thousands of papers, related to things, to different ideas and algorithms in order to find solutions to this problem, approximately, just listing some of them. I'm sure I'm missing many of them. And here you have experts about that. So, but I want just to mention some of the ideas that we have proposed recently. So, we have proposed to do something that we call the consensus-based optimization, which is trying, well, I will explain that by thinking that you have N agents, okay? So you have N explorers that are trying to explore for the minimum of your function, F. And how they are gonna explore for the minimum of the function, F. So you have some tendency to go to consensus, and the consensus means that you want to go to the same location, okay? So you go, you want to go to the same value, say to the same velocity, vt. So vt is your consensus velocity, and you are penalizing if you are not far from that value. Also, you have some noise, and again, the noise strength has some penalization if you are not in the kind of average value for the velocity that you want. And where it enters your function f is because here, in this typical velocity or the consensus velocity I want to find, v of t is an average of the different positions of the explorers with some weights that depend on the function f. I'm going to explain to you next what we do there. So the idea is that we don't want to use the gradient of f. We don't want to use the gradient of f because it might be irregular. So I don't want to use the gradient of f. I just want to use evaluations. So I want these weights depending only on evaluations of point-wise values of f. And here, somehow, we're using these ideas of swarming in the sense that we want to arrive to some consensus in the velocity that will give me the position as eventually of the medium. Okay, so how we choose the wave function, this is reminiscent to people that do simulated annealing. We choose the wave function as exponential of minus f with some parameter that would be the solid annealing, is whatever the temperature of the random variable that you're using. In any case, for us, it's just a parameter. So we choose as a typical weight function, e to the minus beta. And what's the motivation of that? Imagine that we send the number of agents to infinity. This average that we were doing there should approximately be of that form, where rho is the macroscopic density, so the limit of the sum of deducts at the locations of the agents. And this somehow is like similar to a Gibbs type of measure. So if we choose beta small, one can see by Laplace principle that in fact the limit of beta, sorry, not a small but large, when beta is large for small temperature, for beta large, the limit of that quantity is precisely the value of f at the minimum. So somehow the idea that is behind this algorithm is that if you choose the right parameters, you should be close to a Dirac as t goes to infinity at the minimum of f. So the explorers will find the minimum for you. So that's the idea in that direction. So let me show you in practice how it works. I hope the interface starts again. It should start again. Yes. Okay, so here you have just two realizations of finding the minimum of one of the typical functions that people use for that. It's called the accurate function. And with different number of particles, 10 and 30, and different values of the parameters. So my collaborators did a quite fair and thorough study of the practical side of that algorithm. What I've been able to do with them is to prove some theorems about that. So for a certain class of functions f, in fact, we can derive the mean field limit of those kind of equations. Here you have how it looks like. It's a complicated nonlinear Fokker-Planck equation. And in fact, we prove that for certain functions f, we need some regularity, unfortunately, for proving that rigorously. That for certain function f, we prove that as t goes to infinity, the rho of t converges to a Dirac at a location, and that the location is the global minimum of the function. We can prove that for under certain assumptions. So here you have just in one dimension a bit evolution of that. Okay, so this is just, again, one application of these ideas of infinite limits and how they can be useful in certain areas of application. This I thought was a neat way to finish my talk, and thank you very much for your attention.
All right, thank you. Let's open up for questions. Yeah, Steve.
So, you see a bunch of work done on, you know, teaching a machine to do something, you know, robot or something with some sort of, you know, neural learning type thing. And here you have this all. Can you combine those two? Can you imagine a situation where you have a whole bunch of agents that are each being sort of neural learning themselves, and then they're supposed to reach some sort of simultaneous pattern, which you may not know a priori? Does that make sense? Well, yeah, in other words, the machine learns what it is, but at the same time, you're trying to have what it winds up with coordinated across a bunch of entities?
I haven't thought in that direction, but I've seen many people in control engineering trying to get like shapes produced by a bunch of robots and things like that. I haven't thought in that direction, but yes, I think those models of the way of getting that, it shouldn't be that far from mixing these ideas. I haven't looked at that seriously.
Yeah, Sabine.
So in the middle of your talk, you gave a relation of Lasset Poisson,
yeah,
right? And basically, you said that the potential that you introduce sort of in an abstract way could be a Coulomb potential, in which case it becomes Lasset Poisson.
Yes.
And in sort of it's known in real life systems, Lasset Poisson is a small perturbation model, right? You have to be close to the equilibrium. Because if you are far away from the equilibrium, you cannot disregard the magnetic field due to the currents, right? And then you have to do full Maxwell,
but
as opposed to, so is there a room in this formalism to, like, you know, to come up with sort of more realistic models?
Just to put in context your question, yes, Lasset Poisson is like the simplest model for plasmas that you're asking me about. Yeah, I wasn't talking about plasmas at any point, but I agree with your statement that I mean, here you don't disregard if you're thinking about plasma, you disregard completely the magnetic field and so on. You can think about the derivation of plasma Maxwell equations. To tell you the truth, the proof of the derivation of the Lasset Poisson equation, there had been a recent result about it to prove it rigorously, but it has been open for years. Only when the potential is smooth enough, you can derive the that's why I call it Lasset-Fokker-Planck equation with a general potential. But the starting for the case of Poisson, for Coulomb potential, there is no rigorous derivation without cutoff. With cutoff, the rigorous derivation very recently by the group of people in Germany. And it hasn't been published yet, so it's under revision. So for the blast of mass, it would be even more complicated. I don't think there is any result on the rigorous derivation of blast of mass yet. Although, formally, you can write the empirical measure and do the formally.
Yeah.
In your last example, so what are the assumptions, roughly on your functions? Does it
work can we prove?
Yeah.
As I said, unfortunately, we have to assume that the function f is somehow the sum of a C2 function plus something that is globally digits. So for that thing, even if it has a lot of several wells, we can prove that.
And it has to be unimodal also?
No. Okay. It's okay.
Because it's related work by Lester, but he's looking for binomials. Jean-Bernard, yeah.
Ah, okay.
And looking also at the, estimating a Dirac, by convergence of densities, but his construction is different from this one, so interesting.
I don't know that. I mean, I have to say that this has been something quite recent, and I got slightly interested, but I never worked in this direction, so I miss a lot of the references. But then, quite happy to get some feedback on that. So, certainly, yes. So, I would like to have a look. All
right. Any other questions or discussion?
Just by curiosity, so you mentioned weak solutions and Boltzmann. So,
yeah.
Did he formalize the concept of earlier about weak solutions? It was just.
Boltzmann wrote QFF acting on phi. This is already in his book.
Okay.
And he was showing that Q of F acting on the constellations 1, B, and B squared is 0, and that if Q of F phi is 0 for every F, then phi has to be a different combination of the phi. So he, without saying that is the weak formulation, he was working with the weak formulation. Of course, at that time, this wasn't even. But he wrote Q of F acting on that. For him, it was like the observable. phi is observable, Q of F acting on phi is what I can measure, the change of kinetic, the change of time. Yeah, so historically he was using that.
All right, well, let's go ahead and thank Jose again.